Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the first session in the content room on Tuesday of Festival of Media LATAM. Wonderful that so many of you have kept going. We have lunch after this session, so don't you worry, but I'm sure you will enjoy this session. We've talked about purpose, we've talked about inclusivity, but we haven't actually delved deeply into inclusivity over the last couple of days. So to do that, and actually there's been a lot of talk about inclusivity, diversity, a lot of theorizing about it, but actually, are people really putting it into practice in our industry? Well, you'll be pleased to know they are, and to take us through what they're doing is Alejandro Betancourt, who is the Associate Brand Director for P&G.
Thanks, man. Thank you. Appreciate it. Hey, guys, how you doing? So I thought you loved me when you put me on the catwalk. Now you put me in between lunch, so I'm not sure anymore. I think you're cashing in on me. Thanks for being here. I try to be as concise as possible and walk you through what we've called the reinvention of brand building. And the reinvention of brand building begins, or has as its component, reinventing media, moving from mass blast messages and moving more into one-on-one precision, reaching people on a one-on-one basis at scale. Reinventing advertising, moving from purely push messages and doing more balance of push and pull. Also reinventing our agency partnerships. And if you've been reading news, a lot of the work that we're doing with our agencies now, you know, we're leveling that up and we're working, you know, more closer with each other and through our agencies and with our partners in a much more cooperative way. And the fourth element, last but definitely not least, is reinventing marketing as a force for good. If you were earlier in the main stage and you heard Claudia Romo talk about how important it is for brands to take a stance and for companies to take a stance, this is the moment to do it. We feel committed and we feel proud and humbled that we can partake in this effort. So as every story, the story has a beginning, I'm gonna start by the beginning, which is the logical way to do it. Take a look. Oh, video, sorry. Yeah, exactly. Sound off, yeah, exactly. There you go. There you go. Ah, you were paying attention, thank you, man. This is not optimized, yeah? Okay, is it? Are we ready to go? No, we're not. Ah, yeah, there you go.
I realized quickly when I knew I should that the world was made up of this brotherhood of man, for whatever that means. Into a crisis.
So this is the beginning of our story, and the beginning of the story of trying to attack and tackle and deliberately talk and spark conversations around those biases, whether they are very obvious and notorious, like racial bias, or whether they become those little unconscious biases that we have each and every day in each and everything that we do. Try to flag them, try to put them on the table, try to have a conversation, try to spark a conversation, and try to do something about it. So in our effort to do something about it, we have seen that, again, it's no surprise that our consumers want to understand who's behind the brands that they're using. And for us, it's a unique opportunity to be able to connect and show that the values of our users are aligned to our values as a company. We believe that by being a good corporate citizen, we believe that by governing our company with the highest standards, and by also walking the talk internally, not only externally, this becomes a reality. And this is not just some marketing stunt that we do in the external world. Matter of fact, proof that a man, are talking here about gender equality is proof that internally we're walking the talk. We have all been sensibilized around the topic and around the many ways in which we can bring that to life on a day-to-day work and what external impact we can make about it. When you see our citizenship priorities, this is part of the framework that we use. Gender equality is one area, but there are certainly many others which not only belong to the framework that PNG uses, but also are inserted in the global conversation that you saw. I promise you, I didn't ask Claudia to put that slide in her presentation, but are very well aligned to the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations, where, again, gender equality pops out or is clearly called out as an opportunity. We serve every day 2.5 billion women or girls in the world. So we feel we have a responsibility and we have a commitment to make a difference for them, because those voices today are not being equally heard. Gender equality is a topic that we like and that we want to put on the table. And this is going to be the story that I will tell you throughout the course of the next 20 minutes, how we're trying to bring it to life. Now, gender equality, in the end, for us, represents a way to translate the insights that we've understood from serving 2.5 billion women in the world over the course of the past 180 years that the company has been in the market. So understanding those insights, those challenges, and really what they live through on a day-to-day basis has made it very actionable for us, for our brands, for our people, and even for corporate CSR programs or social responsibility programs to come to life in a structured way and as a deliberate systemic effort. The aspiration is here, right? It's very clear. You saw it in the video. It's about seeing equal, but it's about a world that is equal for everybody, regardless of race, you know, gender, position, anything. It's just the ability to see equal has, you know, components that in the case of gender equality come to life through three pillars. First is how do we leverage our brands and being a company of brands and our voice in advertising and media to take a stance on this. We are very humbled and very fortunate to be the largest advertiser in the world, so it only makes sense that that power is put for good. And that is about what marketing, that is what marketing for good is all about. Second, when we look at the opportunities in society, we're trying to tackle them from two fronts: education and economic opportunities. We know that when we help put girls through school, we know that when we help women thrive in their businesses, those communities are better, those communities thrive, and that translates into prosperity for everybody. We know that for a fact, there is data to prove it. So that's the angle that we're taking in that. And third, again, last but not least, is how do we behave internally? It's very easy to stand up here and just, you know, talk a script, but if you don't behave like that internally, if we don't walk the talk in the company, then it's useless. So also internally, we're taking this very seriously, both in terms of what you would think are general, you know, standard criteria of, say, equal representation across all levels of the company, but also in customizing training for men, for instance, to make us all aware of the things that we do on a day-to-day basis that do not foster a gender equal environment, okay? So let me tell you a little bit about each and every one of these. When we talk about using our voice in advertising, we're fundamentally trying to do two things. First is change the language. And if you saw Like a Girl from Always, that was exactly the intent when we launched Like a Girl. There were just language or the way that, you know, certain people, certain conditions were portrayed in advertising that were just not fostering a gender equal environment. And the second thing that we do is try to change long-standing assumptions in society so that through the voice of advertising, we put that on the table, and that hopefully makes an impact either in the form of policy change or simply in the form of social awareness. I'm going to tell you a little bit about each of the cases. We'd Like a Girl, when we put out that iconic commercial in the Super Bowl about 4 or 5 years ago, the results were immediate. We surveyed men and women equally, and we learned that 73% of women and 62% of men, after seeing the video, started considering the word like a girl as a positive term. Think about it, 73% of women, 62% of men. That makes us very proud. What I was telling you about the notions or the assumptions that they live in society, about, you know, two-thirds of kids in India think that doing the laundry is their mom's job. And that's a result of more than 80% of men thinking that the household chores are to be done by the wives. So when we put that out, we said, you know what? There has to be a different way. Ariel, our laundry detergent brand, created a campaign called Share the Load, where more than 2 million Indian men have committed and pledged to help out in the household chores already. It's an online petition you can go in and sign. So it's about putting the topics on the table, creating, generating hopefully a discussion that then translates in change. Another example, Pantene, about 3 years ago, we launched our My Black is Beautiful collection in the US as an acknowledgement and as a recognition to the African-American community living in the US to whom we had neither communicated directly, equally portraying them, nor had designed special products for them. So we took the stance, and for Pantene, strong is beautiful has become sort of like an ethos. And if that's the ethos, then equally and accurately portraying the differences that this great country has is a great way to begin with, right? Fairy, and this is interesting, in the UK, more or less like in India, about 72% of men would say that household chores, you know, are women's territory, right? That's a verbatim for the study. That's not my term. So what we did, as a reminder of making it fair, hashtag make it fair, we took out the Y from the pack. So fairy all of a sudden become fair. As a reminder every day in the households of our fellow Englishmen that the chores of the household are meant to be shared. And there's a fair treatment behind that and behind the movement, hashtag make it fair. This was a campaign that helped us raise awareness on that. SK-II in China, the Chinese society is extremely interesting. But young women suffer a very, very, very big pressure to get married before they're 25 years old. Matter of fact, whenever they cross the 25-year-old mark, it becomes sort of like the talk, the gossip in town within the family. It's like, oh, she's never going to get married, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. With SK-II, we launched the campaign, hashtag Change Destiny, which was aimed at precisely letting people know that the fact that women don't get married by 25 has nothing to do with whether they're going to thrive in life, or that moreover, has to be a choice that they make, not their families. Last but not least, Secret, our deodorant brand, has been always associated to stressful moments for women, right? And this is a case very close to my heart, because today in Mexico, when we ask, what should a woman be? We get very surprising responses for 2018. A good wife is a wife that will be raised in home, will leave her household whenever she gets married, will have kids, will then become a grandmother that then she can pass on the laundry tips and the haircare tips with natural products to her grandchildren. A gender equality survey that we got access to in Mexico said that 63% of Mexicans, all of them Mexicans, thought that a woman should never go out of work unless it's financially, it's extremely a necessity from a financial standpoint. 50% of women still have to ask for permission whenever they want to go out at night with their friends. Think about it, 50% of women. Luckily, there's a movement going on now in Mexico and a set of young girls that are trying to change that. We try to capture that story in the case of Secret behind the following communication. Let me show you and we'll talk more.
¿Por qué uso Secret? Porque en 3, 2, 1. Familia, me voy a vivir con Santiago. Mi abuelita va a empezar a rezar. Mis papás solo van a pensar en sus amigos.
¿Qué van a decir mis amigas?
Y mi hermanita.
Por fin el cuarto para mí sola.
Así son y así los quiero. ¡Me voy!
Secret, no sudes, avanza.
So those very same verbatims that we were reading at the gender equality survey, ooh, what are my friends gonna think? Or no, 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 you cannot move out with your boyfriend. We started putting them on national television. Another example I give you, and we talk more. Oop, sorry about that. Oh, sorry again.
¿Por qué uso Secret? Porque hoy voy a tener que lidiar con esto.
Este es el cuarto del bebé.
O mi estudio de yoga.
Seguramente aquí pasarás mucho tiempo.
No, no tanto.
¿Y qué piensa?
Me lo quedo.
¿Y dónde está su marido para que firme?
Lo está viendo.
Secret. No subes. Avanza.
So there is no better way to deal with misconceptions like this one than to go head on at them and put them out there in the public. And again, take the risk to do it? Yes, why not? If we do it with subtle messages, we'll never get to where we need. We'll never get to a gender equal world if we do that through subtle messages. So really putting the what we call moose on the table is what this campaign is about. Imagine some perceptions of, you know, women that stay at, that not, don't necessarily stay at home, but that go out to work and their husbands need to stay back at home. Sometimes it's even the older generation of women who get in the way of gender equality being a reality. I'll give you an example. We read a heartbreaking fact that was women that are abused by their husbands are more scared to break the news to their moms and grandmas that they're getting a divorce than to actually face the abuser. That's just a heartbreaking fact. So it's the older generations who are also going to start watching this who have to think about what they're doing. And we love to partake humbly in the process of trying to make that reality happen. But what happens when, again, you have a set of women and these brave young women who are starting to change this in Mexico are the stories that we try to capture. Like, for instance, the story of Guillermina, who is a very successful doctor who studied in a Catholic school, so she was expected to just get married, have kids, and stay at home. No, no, no. She's thriving in her career, and in exchange, her husband is the one staying back at home with her. Let's listen to her story.
Yo estudié en una escuela católica de niñas. Mucha parte de lo que crecías en la cabeza era como que sí estudia, pero pues muy probablemente vas a casarte, ¿no? Y te vas a encargar de tu familia. Y como que yo decía, híjole, es que eso no me encanta, ¿no? Soy Guille, soy ginecóloga, soy esposa y soy mamá de dos niños. Hace 5 años me ofrecieron una oportunidad de venirme a vivir acá a Puebla para abrir una clínica de fertilidad y ser la directora de ella. Pues lo platiqué con mi esposo y pues decidimos venirnos y buscar una aventura. Fue que decidimos ser papás. Yo estoy completamente tranquila de que él se hace cargo por completo de ellos, de la casa. Y pues bueno, yo sigo con el trabajo y no hay ningún problema. La verdad, llegó un día mi suegra y me dice, oye, Guille, ¿estás segura de seguir manteniendo a mi hijo? ¿Por qué verlo mal? Porque es hombre y cuando somos mujeres está bien que nos quedemos en la casa a cuidar de los niños, ¿no? Sí se me ha sentido juzgada. Oye, ¿por qué no lo haces que trabaje y que él también aporte algo a la casa? Económicamente hablando, lo que él aporta pues es amor, la tolerancia a estar con los niños, a cuidarlos, a criarlos, a educarlos. En nosotros ha fluido eso bastante bien, no lo hemos visto como raro, pues, sino como pues, algo normal.
Secret, no sudes, avanza.
Seeing Guillermina's story, how the older generation is the barrier for this to become more of a broad-based reality, right? Or what happens when we put labels on certain type of jobs or professions or things to do, and say, no, 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 this is men's territory. I have an example from Lorena I want to share with you.
Estamos un poco educadas a que las niñas tienen un cierto papel y unas ciertas actividades que pueden hacer y otras que no. Y estos deportes se ven como un poco deportes de hombre, lo cual es falso. Soy Lorena Garal, soy atleta de deportes de acción y corro motocross y downhill. Y a partir de que empecé a hacer estos deportes, no sé si me volví mucho más valiente o simplemente salió la valentía que tengo. Por un lado, te tienes que defender para ganarte un lugar como atleta y por el otro, también me tengo que defender para ganar un lugar como mujer. Por ahí tengo historias muy chistosas con mamás de algunos otros pilotos que yo pensaría que sería como, ¡bien, gánale a mi hijo! Pero pues no. Y yo literal escuchaba a los papás y entre los papás, las mamás también, persiguiendo por afuera de las pistas a sus hijos, gritándoles que no podían dejar que una niña les ganara. Cuando todo está en tu contra y todo el mundo te dice que no puedes, que no debes, que no es correcto, como que a veces tú también lo empiezas a dudar, ¿no? Como que dices, bueno, igual y es como necedad o no sé, tal vez no debería estar aquí. Te podrán decir lo que quieran. Si tú sabes que esta es tu pasión y tu camino, haz lo que tengas que hacer, agárrate de donde puedas para hacerlo. El que yo hoy solo me dedique a andar en bicicleta, como muchos dicen, es el paradigma más grande que yo he podido romper.
So it's about empowering that braveness and that confidence that is there. It just hasn't come out. If we can partake in helping that bravery and that confidence to come out, then that's a wonderful way to use our voice in advertising. Now, as an example, the gender equality goes even backstage in the case that I have just shared with you. The director of all the stimuli that you just saw is a woman. Actually, we belong to a movement called Free the Bid, which aims to get equal representation of female directors in the advertising industry. Globally, that number is like 10 to 14%. In Latin America, we're at 34. So I hope next year I can come back and tell you that we hit the mark of 50 in Latin America as the pioneering region of the world, okay? Now, the second piece, and I have a couple more slides for you, is education and economic opportunities. I told you, whenever we put a girl through school or whenever we support entrepreneurial women, we know that community is gonna do better. And that's good for everybody. Now, in areas where water crisis is a reality, usually the average time spent by a family to get safe drinking water for their households is 3 hours one way, 3 hours back. So 6 hours go away in procuring simply fresh and clean water. 40 billion hours, listen to this, 40 billion hours a year are invested in getting fresh, clean water for drinking. Imagine if we could reinvest 40 billion hours in creating new jobs, in education, in putting these people through school, and in working in the communities. With our program, Children Safe Drinking Water, we donate about 1 billion liters of water every year to areas that have water crisis, behind the belief that if we free up that time, that same time is gonna be reinvested in activities that are gonna make the community thrive. Guess what? 80% of the household member tasked with the job of procuring fresh water is a woman or a girl. So that's a girl, and that's a woman who's not going to school. That's a woman who's not spending time in her business. That's a woman that's going to procure water, 40 billion hours. The opportunities are endless. What happens when we try to support the entrepreneurial ecosystem? We have been fortunate enough to be allowed by consumers just like you to be in the market for 180 years. Putting that knowledge at the service of the entrepreneurial community, especially the women-led entrepreneurial community, has been another approach that we've taken in our effort to help communities achieve their maximum economic potential. So we brought 20 business owners, 20 women business owners in Mexico, and we took them through 8 weeks of training in our offices in Mexico City, where each of the members of the different functions that work within the company got to spend time with these women working on their businesses. And actually, it ended up with them pitching their business ideas to our procurement department with two objectives. First, if they do something around the categories where we play, that may translate into a business opportunity for that company. If they don't play in an area that directly touches us, at least they get the expert advice from a procurement professional on how to polish and iron out that pitch so that when they go out to the marketplace, they can do that more effectively. Finally, and this is, Jeremy, we have not announced this. I'm announcing it today here, breaking it the formula. We have just closed a cooperation program with Vital Voices, which is a great global leadership institute that helps alleviate gender equality issues and also works on raising the leadership skills of youth in the world. What we're gonna do is in 5 countries, we're gonna select 5 girls that have proven to have a desire to create a meaningful impact in their communities. We're going to put them through an accelerated leadership program with the goal of accelerating and hopefully amplifying that impact. This is going out, I think, today or by the end of the week. So again, it's just another way of trying to say or trying to show the commitment that towards especially women and girls the company has had. Finally, it's about doing it also. You know, you need to clean the house as well. So walking the talk internally in P&G is not only about equal representation, and it's not only about women. And I want to show you one of my favorite cases. If you look at Latin America's legislation throughout the countries, from Mexico down to Argentina, in the very seldom cases where there is a legal provision for paternity leaves, so fathers that are, you know, have given birth and they get days off, that's not across the region. And wherever there is, that ranges from 2 to 4 days, I think, is the longest. So the company adopted a 3-week paternity leave program sponsored by Pampers so that the old fathers, whenever their babies were born, could be out of the office for 2 to 3 weeks and spend time with their families in a very magical moment of bringing a child for the first time into the household. Okay? So this is not only about gender equality. It's not a women-only type of thing. Yes, that is the biggest problem today, but wherever we spot opportunities to also ensure that men voices are equally represented, we're going to go for it, right? Finally, I'm not going to cover this, but finally, we are extremely proud and humbled to be able to partake in this effort, but this is something we can't do on our own. So we've been partnering with all of these organizations who have way more experience, who have amazing programs, and who ultimately have lent us their hands to work shoulder to shoulder in communities that need this. And we are privileged to partake in that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alejandro. It's wonderful to see a brand taking it seriously and making a difference both internally and externally. Does anyone have any questions for Alejandro? Yes, the microphone just behind you.
Nice presentation, by the way.
Thank you.
I like the Secret campaign.
Yeah.
Very nice, but I've missed something to the other side, focusing or targeting male.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you have or launch any campaign targeting or teaching Mexican male about machismo or how to improve it. You have brands like Gillette or Old Spice. So
thank you. That's an excellent question. And in this case, in the Gillette campaign, it hasn't been like that. When you look at, for instance, Gillette, Gillette's overall equity is the best a man can get. So part of the best a man can get has been around fostering the right values in the education of children. So more and more, you're seeing father and son in Gillette advertising, or you're seeing Gillette, if you've seen the latest campaign in the US, there's an American football player who's disabled, who lost his hand when he was very little, and he's being portrayed that. There's a lot more way to go. We believe that this campaign, in the case of Secret and in the case of Mexican machismo particularly, is the first step, but is by far not over. What we're trying to do also is use some other groups that are not equally represented to be also part of our advertising. So if you know Gus Kenworthy, he's a US Olympian athlete who openly is gay and declared that before the last Olympic Games of Pyeongchang in South Korea. We partnered with him, and he agreed to be our head and shoulders ambassador. And his commercial carried the Pride flag for the first time ever in open TV in the US. So we were very happy to be part of being able to portray also on the men's side, not only on the women's side. But yes, but you're right, we have a lot of work to do on that front. Thank you.
Question, do we have any more questions?
Yep.
And that you were talking about, are you going to open it for other countries in Central America? Because you only talk about 5 countries.
Yeah, so one of those countries, so you mean the Vital Voices one? Yes, so actually one of the 5 countries is Panama. So it's coming in Central America. We're going to run the first set with the 5 countries that you saw on screen. And yes, the idea is to expand it so we can create total coverage. We are blessed to have operations in Central America, so for sure, we would love to give back to a community with those programs.
Just behind you, another question behind you. Excellent. Thank you.
No, just following on these two questions, the Secret campaign, I love. It's really fabulous.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Are you planning to roll that out in any other countries in Latin America?
Yeah, well, so the insight is the same. So whenever women are not equally portrayed, we're going to go after that. Whether it's going to be the same case as you saw it, that may vary based on local, you know, nuances. But yes, but definitely what Circuit wants to stand for is, you know, helping women not to sweat, but to progress.
Yes, there we go.
So how do you deal with short-termism?
Uh-huh.
Mainly from the procurement side, because this is what we all also face on this type of achieving these type of goals. So there is a business imperative here. You know, you make community thrive, you get better, stronger economies, you get a larger economic output, more people handling money, more people buying soap. Okay, so in the long run, it's a solid case. But in the short run, we are all facing the problem of the bean counters just attacking. I need profits now. I need to sell soap now. I know that you want to share some water, but I need to sell the soap this month. Otherwise, I'll be out of a job. So how do you deal with this invasion of short-termism when we're trying to reach long-term goals, which are business goals that are absolutely proven and sustainable in the long run, but hard to keep the mind on the end goal?
Man, great question. Tough to answer. So let me give you two answers on that, right? First is we are trying to prove with data the business opportunity behind gender equality. So last week in the ANA Masters, Mark Pritcher, CEO, was revealing that the opportunity for gender equality in the global economy is equivalent to $25 trillion of wealth creation, right? And even so, when you portray accurately both genders and advertising, when you have agencies that are, you know, equally represented as well, when in advertising you have 50-50 split in female directors, that and that is communicated, that translates in a 10% increase in trust and up to 25% sales uplift. So it's not, again, as we were, the same answer I gave you in the other stage, it's not an or world, it's an and world, right? So we do this, and this is the way we don't have any other campaign on Secret running. This is the relaunch campaign for Mexico, and this is selling. So it's possible to do one and the other. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, well, we got to talk numbers to the number of people. We need to quantify that, to down to earth this.
Sure.
Question, and then yes, one over here. Here we go. You can borrow this.
Is there any research-wide start with Mexico with this campaign? Any particular reason Mexico over any other countries that you thought machismo was, or just?
No. We got a hold of a problem and a consumer insight that was, you know, quite strong. Again, when I quoted the figures of the gender survey that we got access to, of, you know, plus 60% of Mexicans thinking that the role of a woman is to, you know, get married, have children, raise their children, become a grandmother, and that. So we thought that was quite a pressing issue. And when you brought the brand in, it made sense for the brand to enter that territory. So that's part of the authenticity of the brand speaking about this. Had it been any different brand, I'm not sure there would have been a click there, right? But considering the business case at hand, the business challenge at hand, and the market reality, we thought that accurately portraying the situation that was going on in Mexico was something that was going to resonate with our Secret audience.
Okay, last two questions. There we go. Microphone on you now.
Okay, I'm an extra PNG, but it's been a long time. I don't know how it works right now.
Once PNG, always PNG.
Yeah.
Yes. Well,
I'm Duracell, so.
Yeah, exactly. You're really here for the family.
So I just want to understand right now what's the stand, how PNG stands in the point of how does this reflect in maternity leaves and on salary differences? How do you reflect the communication for the consumers, actually, for people that work in there?
Yeah, so now when you say communication to consumers, you're referring to, so the first two questions alluded to more
something
internally.
I know we. You guys are communicating a lot of.
PNG hard,
I know have a lot of communication platforms communicating equality. How does that reflect inside with the policies you have about women differences in salaries and specifically about maternity leave? That's something that usually it's tricky.
So I there again, two answers for that. When we look at our, so we have clear targets by position, business unit, level, where we aim to have an equal representation, so a 50-50 representation. In many of the business units where we operate, particularly in Latin America, we've hit that target. In some others, we're still making progress, but at least we've called it and we measure that. The most important thing is we declare it and we measure it, right? So it's a common responsibility of the business unit owner, of our HR partners, to make sure that we're working there. We may not have the 50-50 today, but we have a career slate of saying, okay, who's gonna replace this person and are we gonna hit the target, yes or no? Okay, and on the maternity leave is the same. I mean, we give, typically, there's always, I would say nobody normally only takes the legally allowed time. We open the space for them to stay as long as needed. Yes, as long as needed for with their children. Right? We believe that's very important. Thank you for the question.
Good question. Sorry, the last one, just in the corner. Yeah, I gotta give you this one.
Yep.
Well, first of all, congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, it's very refreshing to know that we can do much more than sell an item, just making people's lives better, right? But no, my question is that this gender equality also goes to your media implementation and communication strategies. To be more specific, is that there's a tendency in household products that to target just women because the assumption is that their household products are bought by the housewife. So whenever we try to target men buying soap or buying cleaning products, they say, no, it's the woman that buy them. Are you focusing or targeting men in your household products?
Yes, I can tell you of, without naming names, a big country in the region and a big brand, one of our marquee brands, that has typically been targeted at housewives, which we have started to do men as well, right now. So we're testing that. We've seen very early, so positive feedback in the very early stages, and we think that's a use case that goes both ways. That will mean also that eventually we will start talking about, say, Gillette to women as well, right? You know, so it goes both ways in terms of how we implement the media strategy, but it's definitely something that we're looking into. And we have, again, I can't disclose the brand or the country, but suffice it to say, it's not a small thing in the other side of the world. It's here in Latin America, one of the brands we take care of that we started to do that with very positive results, frankly. It has surprised us all. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, audience, for your questions. I think it's great to have such a brave and bold brand. Thank you, Alejandro.